afternoon session. So I present the ViSenze to do this kind of sharing with you guys. So let me introduce myself. So my name is Hou Dejun. So I'm an engineer manager of the ViSenze. So I joined ViSenze almost around more than 6 years already. So today, my topic I want to talk about site reliability engineer practice in ViSenze. So before I start, so can I understand how many people you guys to know what site reliability engineer means? If we compare with the DevOps, yes.
So I'm just making sure that whatever thing you do works reliability.
Yes. So generally speaking, yes, it's like that. So the hope, you know, the goal is to make sure. So whenever you develop service, when you provide any service to some customer, you make sure the system running reliable for the users. Yeah. Okay, so before I start, I want to quickly introduce our company. So yeah, our company ViSenze. So we are a global leader in visual AI solution for retailer. So this is our focus on retailer. So we have, this is all the, you know, customer. You can see we have Rakuten, Uniqlo, and Myntra, Jingdong, Adidas, ASOS, and Mango, this kind of company. Some kind of companies, they come from retailer. Some companies, maybe it come from like e-commerce sites as well. Yeah. So currently in ViSenze, we run in two kind of business line. One is enterprise business line. So we selling all the technology to some enterprise customer. So like this company is the enterprise customer. And the other kind of business line is we call it as B2B2C. So that means we provide some service to end users to provide some kind of experience. Later, we have a quicker introduce. So we have been mentioned by 3 times for the top 10 technical employee and we also be mentioned by our Prime Minister Nihon Long. So highlight ViSenze along with the Razer and SEA as the, you know, example success company in Singapore region. So this is our typical user case I just mentioned already just now. So the first one is B2B. So we face to the customer, we provide this kind of technology. So you can see here, so this is a user case. So when our enterprise customer integrating our technology, they can put this kind of technology into their website and to enable this kind of visual search experience. For this is a user case, they can take the picture, what they have provided the user, then they can trigger a search to find their product. Okay, so this is a user case. The second one I mentioned is B2B2C. So this is, so we are cooperating with some kind of OEM card partner like Samsung and Vivo and LG, this kind of OEM partner. They integrating our technology into their, you know, native camera. So that means, so when you buy a new Huawei, LG and Vivo phone, so the native will have our technology inside. You can open the camera and you can see this kind of function. So this is a user case like the Samsung. So you can use your phone, port to any kind of product, anything you want to search, and the system will automatically detect the object and trigger visual search. So that's backend powered by us. Yeah, this is just now the user case I mentioned. Though, this is Samsung, how they integrate with us. So this is the user experience they have. This is Huawei. Huawei is integrating us with us the same, but the user experience is a little bit different, but the overall the scenario is the same. This is LG, how they integrate with us as well. Yes. So we are growing. So currently as ViSenze, we're running our service globally because our customer is globally. So we have some customers in Europe, some maybe in US and in China as well. So that's by default, we need to make sure our service can be, you know, running globally to better serve our customer. So currently we have 6 cloud center, deploy in the global region. So we have Japan, US, Europe, and Singapore, China as well. Yeah. And especially for the last years, so you can see all the traffic growing. So almost 3 times of the traffic compared with the same time in the last years. That's how we growing so faster. So also this is also bring some challenge for us. So definitely first one is global service management, because you need to manage your service globally, right? To service global users. The second one is rapid, quick traffic growing. So I can say in the following years, we have more and more user and the traffic will come in and growing. So that's why the traffic growing is very fast. The third one is more complex, because your system will be more complex when your system be scale or larger. And so when this one happen, how to make sure maintenance are good, service level agreement with the customer, with the users, this is one of the challenges as well. And last challenge is when you have some service reliability things happen, we so call incidents, right? If incidents happen, how we can quick response for this incidents so that we can save the user experience yes. So that's the challenge we are facing. So that's why we are trying to bring this kind of site reliability engineer in ViSenze culture and to improve our the overall service availability. Yeah. So why reliability is so important though? I think this one is very straightforward, right? You guys, so when, okay. So think about if I am one of my potential partner and a customer, they see our website, this is just example. So they look for our website, right? But if suddenly, so they say, okay, the website, why I cannot see anything, right? So then what, how do you think the user will think about our system, right? And then maybe later, our system is broken, right? So this kind of experience is very, very bad, only speaking, right? So if this is a very important partner, they say us, okay, they are thinking, oh, this company, that this company still running this service, that the company still can provide a reliable service to us, right? So this is a very typical user case. So any kind of company, they have this kind of problem, right? So back to our case, so ViSenze, we are providing that kind of visual search to our customer. So when the end user, if I want to use my phone to trigger search to find the product, right? The search itself to trigger, I need to wait a very, very long time to get the product to be returned. Then I lose interest in to continue use it. At the same time, because we are bringing this experience to the users, we also want to bring the user this kind of shopping experience, right? So from business perspective, we are losing the revenue, right? Lose the money, right? So that's business perspective. So this one, so think about this. So reliability always is very important as a company. No, it's not just the user experience problem, also it's a business problem as well. So actually, what's a site reliability engineer? So this is the concept is rest out by Google at the first time. So in Google's definition is a site reliability engineer is a discipline that incorporation aspect of the software engineer that applies them to the infrastructure and the operation problem. The main goal is to create a scalable and high reliability software system. So this is the definition of the Google. When the Google first come out this concept, they come out this idea. So in the following few slides, I will share how we practice this kind of site reliability engineer in us. So I will share how we run this kind of operation from the traditional way to our the current way, and how we define our reliability and how we run our monitor system. Because if we talk about the reliability engineer, monitor is a very critical part. Yeah. And then I will also share about how we improve our reliability. We talk about reliability, right? So how can we improve it, right? So in this improved planning, so we are talking about the traditional DevOps pipeline, and as well as a new our infrastructure and the change management strategy. So in the last few, I also want to share a kind of postmortem culture. So this is very important if you want to get a good reliability in the culture. Postmortem is very important. Make sure you can learn it from the instance. As well as last part is SRE metrics. So if we're running SRE, so how can we make sure our SRE is efficient, right? To compare with other, strategy, compare with DevOps, compare with other company, how can we make sure we are running better? Any question? Okay, so this is the way how we come to right now. So when the first time, so when we launched this, we're running the company, so we also running a very standard, traditional operation way. So we have our dedicated operation guys, they do this kind of operation. So when the developer, they'll have a feature be released, be delivered, right? They need to pass something to the operation guys. The operation guys, in charge of push this one in running all the cloud service, right? So this is the first stage. So but when we running this model for a few years, so we find some problems we are right. So later I will share you some what kind of problem we face. Then we move to the DevOps. This is DevOps is very common practice in the industry and for a few years already. So then we introduce DevOps to continue improve our the practice, improve our the reliability. But we still face some problem, right? So what's the problem? Yeah, that's the question. So later I'll share with you guys. And then finally, right now, we move to the reliability engineer. So that we can use the kind of software approach to manage operation, manage reliability stuff. Let's think back to the when I talk about the operator. So what's the challenge of the operation? So in the operations this model, there are two kind of people. One is a developer, one is the operator, right? So the developer is always think about how can I quickly finish my code and finish my features and push the feature to online. This is a very straightforward mindset. And for operator, the main charge is okay. I need to make sure your online system is stable, right? And is reliability, right? So this is the position how we assign this kind of position. So the problem is the operator, they don't understand the code, they don't understand how you running the code, how you write the code base, right? How your system running underlying. So this they have a little understanding regarding this one. For developer, the problem is the developer, normally developer only focus on the feature development, coding, this kind of stuff. They have a little understanding the operation practice. So what's operation practice? Normally we maybe think about, right? So when you face a problem, how you quickly to make sure the service can be, come back, revert back. This is kind of operation, maybe practice. But normally for us, the developers, they lack this kind of mindset because they don't have this kind of experience. So this misalignment always bring a lot of kind of conflicts because the developer, I want to push the feature because there is pressure from product manager, maybe from company side. They want to finish this feature as soon as possible, right? But if as operator, I need to make sure the service as stable as possible, right? You can slow down, let's slow down. Then with the service, maybe I can have more time to make the service be stable, right? This is the kind of conflicts normally we are facing when we do this kind of running this kind of operator, model. So what's the problem, yeah? So the problem is, not alignment between this operator and the developer. So this is how DevOps, this concept come out. The DevOps is a set of practice that automatically they process between software developer and the IT team. So they want to build some kind of practice to reduce this gap so that they can alignment regarding the service reliability. So in the DevOps, there is five, you know, key practice they always want to implement. The first one, reduce organization silos. What that means? So that means, so we don't want to very, you know, a straight, you know, barrier to between developer team and the IT team. So how we can make these two teams together to make the software developer more stable. So this is one of the principles. They always want to reduce this kind of organization silo. The second principle they practice, actually call it practice, they highlight is accept failure as normal. Because normally software running in server, right? The server is hosting the data center. The server is definitely not a reliability, right? Network also is not reliable, you know? And as well as most of service also need to bring like the human operation, right? So this one will be more complex. So the reliability will be more problem, more challenging. So failure is a common problem for any service. No kind of service can guarantee, okay, 100% reliable. That's not possible. Yeah. So this one we need to accept this problem. The third one, the practice DevOps, they want to try to, you know, enhance is implemented gradual, you know, changes. When you do some changes to the online, they try to avoid some big change as one time. So if you have big change, can we break down to some small change one by one slowly so that I can quickly, you know, to if there any problem happen, I can quickly identify which one brings this problem, right? So if I can quickly rolling back if the system is broken. So that's why they come out this principle is a gradual change. So make sure always do some minor change first, then verify, then push the next one. So this is one another principle. The next principle they also want to is try to leverage some tool or automation way to reduce the human operation so that we can use a software strategy, make the system be running more smooth so that one. So reduce definitely will help us. The last one is measure everything. So when we talk about DevOps, so you need to make sure everything is measurable, is controllable, and is monitorable. Yeah. So this is the principle when we talk about DevOps. They want to, you know, to highlight. So then we talk about SIE. So if we treat DevOps as kind of program language, so what's the difference of SIE, right? So just like I mentioned, DevOps is kind of the come out as kind of principle, right? And practice you should do, but how you do, maybe different company, different you know organization, they have a different idea, they have a different you know learning, right? So SRE, you can think about SRE is a concrete you know implementation of DevOps. If we think about from the computer, you know, in the software perspective, this. They will be like this. So when some companies or when some guy will ask you, what's the difference of the DevOps? What's with SRE? Maybe from my perspective, I cannot say too much different. It's just like a SRE make the implementation way give you a more concrete guidance how you do it. Yeah. So that's the idea. So when we talk about you know site reliability, so I heard about this one is the most the first one we always hear about. So when you talk about some customer, when you talk about with some kind of user, they will ask you first question is, can you share me what's your service's SLA, right? A few years ago when I hear about this one, I will have a question mark. What's your SLA means? You are talking about the latency, you are talking about the service availability, or you are talking about visual search. So you are talking about visual search performance, search accuracy. So this is a different definition. So when you talk about SLA. So that's why SRE practice, they put this one as the first one we want to emphasize. So make sure either us as a company or our customer, let's have an agreement what SLA means, right? So when in Google, the definition as a site reliability, they break in down SLA into three kind of level. The first one, so we need to have a define SLA, SLI. So when you talk about SLA, so let's define separate different kind of metrics you want to talk about. So your SLA can cover latency, right? You can cover maybe availability, maybe related with error rate, like this kind of thing. Or you maybe talk about some kind of other kind of performance standard. So let's define. So this is what SLAI means. Service level indicator. So choose the indicator, which one you want to represent your service reliability. Then if we have a SLI indicator, then we can define the objective. So for latency, so for example, we can define as us. So our service latency, I can guarantee 1 second for every, maybe not every, definitely maybe 99%, 1 second, less than 1 second. This is the objective. So we can define this kind of objective. Then after you have a range of this kind of object together, put together, this one we are calling as a SLA. So SLA is more like a service level agreement. So it's kind of contract that a service provider promise customer our service availability and performance. So this is the relationship between this concept. Yeah. So overall, so the SLI drive SLO, and then SLO, so put together, which inform as SLA. Any question regarding this one? A little bit confused somehow, yeah. Because there are so many new concepts you need to be defined. So let's think about the, we gave some example. For example, availability. So how we define availability, so in terms of SLI and SLO. So availability, so normally, so we are use this kind of formula to define. So how many API? So this API, first you need to define our API, what kind of scenario the API is success or is non-success, right? So this one company, they have different definition. For example, a typical definition, maybe a kind of single 500 to this kind of high 500 is, and we treat a kind of failure, right? Or other, maybe I treat a success, maybe like this. So we can define this one first. And then we can use a count of the overall success API and, divide your overall, count of overall API. So then you can get a ratio number. So this is the availability of your service in terms of availability. This is one service level indicator, right? Then if you have this indicator, then we talk about the object. So what's object? So how can, which one we can guarantee to our the customer, right? So maybe for example, I can guarantee 97% of the API call is success. So this is object. So you also can have some other kind of indicator to represent your service reliability as well. For example, we can talk about latency. So when we talk about any service, we have two aspects. One is the availability, one is the latency, right? So when we talk about latency, so we can, how do I design the SLI? So we can use a count of API duration. For example, when we talk about this one, you need to have an agreement with your product or with your service, with your customer, which kind of latency arrangement is acceptable. So this one, this is the first thing we need. For example, in our case, let's think about, so our API latency, make sure less than 500 milliseconds. This is the accept standard. Then we always use this one to measure. So we can define our service level indicator is how many API call, the latency is less than 500 milliseconds, and then I divide to the overall API call. So this is your latency service level indicator. So then come then we need to think about what's objective, right? How reliable we can guarantee the user, right? You also need to define the number as well. For ViSenze, we always choose the 99% as our standard. So this is a typical user example. So if you don't, just now I share some example, if you don't have a good idea how to define this one, there is kind of four golden yellow metrics. This is reference. You can just use it. Latency definitely is the most important one if you are service provider, So you always think about from latency first. And then is the error. Error rate is also is match with the availability just now I mentioned. Because when we talk about error, there are a few kind of error type. The first one is a HTTP status error. So this one is very easy to catch. Another kind of error is busy. Sometimes, for example, the HTTP calling is a success, right? But your service side is giving me some, system busy information or some kind of API, exceeds the limitation. This kind of error, we also treat that error because this. The last one, maybe some kind of other kind of error, maybe some of the parameter is invalid, or you give or your response an empty result. Also, you can treat that as kind of error. So this is subject how you define your business. Traffic. So I haven't mentioned the traffic is also important. So you also need to define the traffic, SLA. Because with all this one, you don't know how much traffic you have and what's the capacity your system can support. So this one matrix also is very important as a company. You need to define this one. Saturation. Saturation is the concept is so for example, the current your system may be running 100 in those instance in cloud. So if we get it, have this instance group. So how much kind of service I can support in, right? We can break it down into few kind of metrics. So like I/O, so what's I/O ratio, right? And the CPU utilization, and the memory utilization, and the disk utilization. So you can know what's the current load and what's my capacity. So if for example in us, so we set a very strict standard process is like, for example, the memory hit 80%. I think is a worrying information. I will trigger alerts and monitor, and let our engineer try to fix it. This come back to just what I mentioned the metrics. So in ViSenze, we also follow this standard to implement all the metrics definition. So here is the application layer. So it always have availability, error rate, and the latency, and the throughput, this kind of metrics definition, and keep into our monitoring. And in the bottom layer, so we have like a Kubernetes infrastructure. So all our services in running in Kubernetes. So in the Kubernetes, we can connect some kind of metric as well, like a CPU utilization, memory utilization, and some other events as well. This kind of thing. The last layer is a fundamental like a physical server layer. I also can connect some kind of metrics like the physical server, CPU utilization and the memory and the disk usage. So this is how we all this kind of metric also can match with just I mentioned the four golden metrics definition. In ViSenze, all these metrics we connect automatically connect or use one this kind of promises this industry standard service. Then if you get this metrics pushed to this one, this service will help you to define them, easily to define the monitor, strategy. Like you can send them monitor to email, to Slack or page duty, this, and then you also can trigger some you know, operation escalation policy as well. So this is how we invest into running monitor system. Any question? The monitor setup so also is very important one. You need to make sure the monitor is open. Everyone can access it. So we also build this kind of dashboard, so make sure the monitor is open to everyone to access. So everyone can go into our system to look at how our service is running. So how many API calling fail, how many, what's the latency, the current running status. So all this information in our dashboard. Another important thing, so this monitoring is just information from our side, right? So another kind of angle we also monitor is from the end user perspective. So how, for example, our we are Singapore. So we get it, okay, I can get the information from the server log, understand our latency, right? But how do you think if the user is come from Russia, right? If the user come from China, if the user is come from US, what's the latency difference? So this also is very important because always when you talk about the monitor, you also need to think about from the user perspective, the end user perspective. So we build this kind of, you know, this kind of dashboard. We also can easily understand which part is the latency most higher one. So this you can see here. So some of the dark part is the latency very, very high. So this one will highlight to our engineer. So oh, this part is the latency is not so good. So we need to think about how to improve this part. So learning, we running morning quite aggressive. So we learning a lot, you know, from the last few years. So in terms of monitor perspective. So when we first to running this monitor system, we'll choose some running metrics, like we use average. So this is very, very, you know, easy to do by some company. So any company, when they start this monitor, they always use it. You know, average to represent the performance, but this average maybe have a misleading, so you will ignore some problem really. So then we find this problem, then we switch the monitor to the late percentage. So we always use 95% and more aggressive. You can use 99% of the latency to measure your system, right? So for example, so for our service, from average perspective, maybe we can achieve 300 milliseconds. Right, this looks quite good, right? But some user still not happy because somehow, sometimes the service response maybe take a few seconds. But from the if you monitor average, okay, service look good. But this doesn't really reflect the user's experience. So if we can use 99%, so this one more close to the end user. So and then we can use this one more, put this more straight, you know, strategy to push our engineer to fix, to think about from any single user. Another one I just now mentioned the geographic monitor system, right? That's very important. Because when we talk about monitoring, you need to monitor from the user point. So you are not just think about from our own, you know, service operator point. So for example, some customer maybe they come from Europe, they calling us, okay. So why your latency is so unstable? Looks like this. But when our operation guys to look at our service, my service is quite stable. What happened? So this is very hard to management if you just looking this data from our perspective. So that's why we build this kind of monitor from end user. Okay, can we set some kind of monitor, you know, agent in the Europe? Let us check from there and to understand, to check what really happened from this kind of view. So that's why how we build this. So we continually optimize this kind of long tail user experience. So that's why match with all the standard. We always use 99% for our monitor, you know, monitor standards. This is a monitor, so we build this kind of monitor system. is very quick. Without good monitor, you don't know what will happen yours for your users. Yeah, DevOps pipeline. So just now we talk about the service reliability definition and how we connect the metrics to understand your reliability, right? So then we talk about how to improve the pipeline, how to improve the reliability. So in ViSenze, we also follow a traditional, you know, DevOps culture to build a few kind of pipeline to help work together with our developer to provide tools to fasten their, you know, develop speed, you know, iteration speed. So we have the CI pipeline, so we can help them to quickly, you know, without any too much stuff, so they can quickly, you know, to run this kind of building stuff. Like I can building the artifacts and running unit testing and build some Docker and push Docker, this kind of thing. And the second pipeline is like a delivery. So this delivery is not a deployment. So when you have a service be ready, so you need to test it to verify it is correct, right? So as a ViSenze, we are unit one because we have a lot of kind of algorithm part. So when we have algorithm, you know, release, how can you make sure the algorithm output is accuracy is not doesn't break? So there is a lot of kind of testing you need to running before you really push it on it. So we have this kind of continue deliver pipeline. Whenever a code changes submit, or whenever a data scientist or data engineer, they have this kind of new model be released, we also need to run in this pipeline to make sure this one doesn't break all the system. So this is how pipeline to design like this. And the last kind of pipeline is deployment. So when you have finished your testing, verification, evaluation, then we can move to the deployment. So we also build this kind of pipeline for all the developers. They don't need to touch the infrastructure. They just use this system, can easily for them to quickly launch our deployment to our production system and without too much concern regarding break the system itself, because the pipeline itself can help them to resolve all these problems. So this is pipeline. So because I just mentioned the DevOps principle, one of the principle is leverage automation and the tools, right? This is why how we build this kind of internal tool to improve our productivity. Another you know, strategy we I invested we also enhance is change management infrastructure as code principle. So how many people do you know the infrastructure as code means? Any guy know what it means? So infrastructure as code, this is very, so when we do the operation things, they let you change your mindset. So normally when they do the operation, if we follow traditional way, how we do it? A guy, operation guy, SSH, maybe SSH, access our cloud service, or log into AWS service, Google Cloud service, right? And do some change configuration. Maybe click some button or open some page, this kind of operation stuff. They're doing like this, right? Then maybe repeat this task every day. Then finish the, then the service will be follow your instruction. So this is a typical operation way, right? What's the problem? So yeah, the problem is this kind of operation is easily to break because you have this kind of human stuff be there, human operation be there. Then maybe the people don't, you know, maybe, you know, miss operation, miss click the wrong button, suddenly maybe delete your service as well, right? This is very dangerous. So this kind of thing always happened in as our company. So in the few previous years, always happened. What, and even the guys working in our company, maybe a few years, very experienced, but still they have some chance they have this kind of miss operation. They suddenly click some button, and then break my system, really. Happened a few times. So that's why I keep thinking about how can we save this pipe? how can we avoid this kind of thing happen? So that's why I'm coming. We are borrowing this idea infra as code chain, this concept. So what does it mean? Infra code is define your infrastructure as user code base, user code. Like software engineer, when you define an API, right, you write a code, in writer you some can use some code logic and flow to make it combine and combine into a kind of runnable. So the same. So when you talk about operation, can you define your operation using code? If you define your operation as a code base, right, then I can bring the very traditional software practice to verify your operation. I can validate your operation because you are code, right? I code, I can run in testing. I can bring the review. I can bring the audit to make sure this thing doesn't break my system as well. So this is the difference. But overall, the benefit is you can control the operation. Because nobody can directly touch your system. So when they want to touch system, they need to change something into code. Right? So that I can prove the code. If without proof, the code cannot be pushed online. So this is the mindset change. So I just mentioned, talk about improve the tools, have these kind of automations. So when if the real incident happen, how we do it, right? So this is you need to have a kind of incident management practice. So in ViSenze, we have this kind of incident management practice. So always have a communication as a first priority. Your communication is very important if you have a good response, you know, incident management strategy. And the second one is operation. So if you want to have a good incident management, you know, practice. So one important role is very important. So first one is a commander. Always have one single commander to control all this kind of cooperation and coordination things. And then the commander need to design some, you know, assign some operation lead to do this kind of operation stuff. So this is also is how we get you do the operation. Another one is very important postmortem. Because we in ViSenze, we also have a lot of incidents happen every month, every quarter. So how can we learn from this one to improve ourselves? So we build this kind of postmodern culture. But the first one for postmodern culture is very important one. You need a blameless. So otherwise, the engineer will don't want to do this postmodern anymore. So we have built a few kind of practice. And the culture to running this postmortem. So how to measure the SRE? So we running SRE quite a long time. So how to measure my team is work efficient? So we also define this kind of metrics to measure. So overall, so we have three kind of critical metrics to measure our teams. So first one is the time to detection. So when an incident happen, how quickly the incident can be this event can be detected by our system or by our users. This is one of the metrics. Another one is when the event is be detected, how quickly my engineer can jump in and do some action. So this is time to engage. And last one is very important, how long time to fix. How long time you spend your engineer to fix this issue. So this kind of three metrics is very important to measure how efficient you're running in your company. So we build this dashboard. We can continue monitor my team, how efficient they are. So like how many alerts, how long time the engineers need to engage to this alert, how long time they can fix this alert. Some other kind of strategy is, so when you define your SLL, I just mentioned, so you need continue improvement. You cannot just, currently we define 95% is latency less than 1 second. Use only this standard to measure all this. Because the system needs improvement, so you can continue improve your monitor and improve the system. Another important, practice we enhance in ours. So we treat SRE as very critical, team. So when we have a new feature delivery or new feature planning, we always want to push my SR engineer team with to join the tech design from very, very first stage to join the team activity so that the team can understand what happened for this feature, right? What's the requirement for the user? How I or engineer to design this system so that they can better understand the system. Then they can do, so when the thing happens, so they have a good way to solve the problem. So this is very important. So co-join with the tech team, engage the SRE engineer in the tech design and review. Another one is a playbook. So when the same event happens, so you need some playbook to run in so that you can easily to solve the problem. So that not only SRE engineer, so any engineer can solve the problem. Here is the last one is our the tech stack, overall tech stack. I think this is quite standard in the industry. So the Jenkins side, it's build side, we have Jenkins, Docker, GitHub, and some code checking standard. And the pipeline, so we have Spinnaker, and Terraform, Ansible, and HIM, and Slack, this one to build the pipeline channel, this tech stack. The infrastructure channel, so we always use AWS and Google. This is one of our cloud provider. And Kubernetes is our infrastructure standard, always use Kubernetes. And some vendor to help us manage the service. The monitor standard, we have promises, Datadog, InfluxDB, and BigQuery, OpsGenie, and Grafana, this kind of text. Yeah, thank you. So, any question? So yeah, we are currently, we also open some position to, we welcome some fresh graduate student, and if you want to have some intern and work in our company, so you also can access our website to get some open position, so you can, if you have interest, you can apply online. Yeah, thanks.